Good morning. Welcome to Redeemer Lutheran Church. I'm Pastor Kevin McReynolds, and it's my pleasure to be able to serve you today and serve you with the word of the Lord, which the promise that we have in Scripture is that that word grants faith, and faith gives to us the keys to eternal life. And so we thank God for this word that he gives to us today, and I look forward to sharing with you a word of promise. Today we'll be looking at the Lucan version in today's gospel, the Lucan version of the Beatitudes, which is sort of a famous set of sayings of Jesus. And I've never really taken time to study it. It's not that I've not had this text come up to preach in the past, but I've never taken the kind of time to study it like I did in preparation for today's sermon. Normally, where I've seen these Beatitudes and where I've engaged with them or encountered them and then preached on them is from the Matthean version from Matthew chapter 5. So we see today that in the Lucan version, they're a little bit different, so I'm excited to share that with you today and look forward to doing so. We have a special treat today with the choir doing special music for us. So as we have done in the past, we will let them sing first what would have been their special music piece. And then during the time of special music, when we would normally have collected our offerings during church here, which we're still doing in the back due to some of the COVID restrictions, we will put that hymn that was the opening hymn for our first service. We'll kind of flip-flop on the two. So we will let them get us started today. I'll turn it over to the choir to open our worship service.
Calling from the grace, and I come. Please rise for worship. We make our beginning this morning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake he forgives you your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Our service continues with today's intro. It's spoken responsively. I will praise you with an upright heart when I learn your just and righteous decrees. Blessed are those whose way is blameless, whose walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are those who keep his testimonies, who seek him with their whole heart. You have commanded your precepts to be kept diligently. Oh, that my ways may be steadfast in keeping your statutes. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. I will praise you with an upright heart when I learn your just and righteous decrees. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks. We praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. graciously hear the prayers of your people, that we who justly suffer the consequence of our sin may be mercifully delivered by your goodness, to the glory of your name. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated for our readings.
The Old Testament reading is from Jeremiah 17, verses 5 through 8. Thus says the Lord, cursed is the man who trusts in man and makes flesh his strength, whose heart turns away from the Lord. He is like a shrub in the desert and shall not see any good come. He shall dwell in parched places of the wilderness, in an uninhabited salt land. But blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose trust is the Lord. He is like a tree planted by the water that sends out its roots by the stream and does not fear when heat comes, for its leaves remain green, and is not anxious in the year of drought, for it does not cease to bear fruit. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle reading is from 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 through 20. Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved. If you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, and that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas and then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unworthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace towards me was not in vain. On the contrary, I work harder than any of them. Though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we preach and so we believe. Now if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has been raised, then our preaching, if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain, and your faith is in vain. We are even found to be misrepresenting God, because we testified about God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise, if it is true that the dead are not raised. For if the dead were not raised, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in this life only we have hoped in Christ, we are all people most to be pitied. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. I invite the congregation to rise as we join together and sing the Alleluia in verse.
Alleluia, Lord, to whom shall we go?
You have the words of eternal life. Alleluia.
Hear now the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 6th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus came down with them and stood on a level place with a great crowd of his disciples and a great multitude of people from all Judea and Jerusalem and the seacoast of Tyre and Sidon, who came to hear him and be healed of their diseases. And those who were troubled with unclean spirits were cured. And all the crowd sought to touch him, for power came out from him and healed them all. And he lifted up his eyes on his disciples and said, Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you shall be satisfied. Blessed are you who weep now, for you shall laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you and when they exclude you and revile you and spurn your name as evil on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for behold, your reward is great in heaven, for so their fathers did to the prophets. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full now, for you shall be hungry. Woe to you who laugh now, for you shall mourn and weep. Woe to you when all people speak well of you, for so their fathers did to the false prophets. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
Please be seated as we sing our sermon hymn number 394.
Thank you.
Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you all from God our Father and our risen Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The text for today's message comes from the gospel lesson you heard read just a moment ago from Luke, the 6th chapter. So have you ever seen the television show Let's Make a Deal? I don't know that I've ever watched a full episode all the way through, but I know the premise of it because when we lived back in Nebraska in the parsonage that was located right next door to the church, sometimes I'd go home for lunch, and my lunch always seemed to be a bit of a late lunch. And my wife would have the TV on in the living room, and sometime around the 2 o'clock hour, Let's Make a Deal came on TV. Now I told her, hey, why don't you shut the TV off, because she'd never be watching it, but she said, I always know what time it is by what shows are on the television. And I'm like, turn the TV off, get a watch. I mean, it's simple to me, but whatever. So like I say, I've never really watched the show, but I know the premise that stands behind it. It's a daytime television game show that started way back in 1963 with Monty Hall. He was the original host. He served in the role until 1986. And today, the show that I was most familiar with was watching it with Wayne Brady as the host. And the format remains largely the same. People dress up in goofy costumes to try and attract the attention of the host, who then invites them to come win prizes and money through participation in various kinds of games. And in one version of these games, the contestant has to pick from a series of doors. They can pick whatever prize is behind door number one or door number two or door number three, and then the host tries to get them to second guess themselves. Maybe they have to trade in something that they've won previously. And if the player chooses wisely and trades something in for the right door, they may get something special, like a new kitchen appliance or a vacation package to somewhere, or even a brand new car. But if they choose poorly, you guys know what they get? A zonk. Yeah, it's nothing, you're right, it's nothing, but they call it a zonk. Right, it's some kind of an unwanted booby prize is what a zonk is, which is nothing, or at least they put something silly out there for people to get and worthless. Picking a door becomes an all or nothing affair. You're either going to gain something, you're going to trade in something that you've got or get to pick there, and you're going to gain everything that you didn't have before, or you're going to lose. You get something very good or something bad. Choose the right door and win. Choose the wrong door and zonk. The reason I bring up this game show is because I thought of it with regard to the gospel lesson. I think there is some similarity. You may wonder if it was Monty Hall or Wayne Brady or zonks or whatever, and how does that relate to Jesus? I'm talking about the all or nothing that goes on in there in Let's Make a Deal. Because in our lesson, Luke employs this kind of mentality when sharing with us a part of Jesus' teaching. It's a teaching method that had been employed for many centuries, even before Luke employed it. It was a didactic method, a teaching method used to share truths with God's people, a means of catechesis. That's the fancy word for today, like when we're trying to teach God's people, we use a catechism, which is a didactic tool, to teach people the truths of the Christian faith. There's a method of teaching that's employed in the way Luke presents Jesus teaching the Beatitudes today. And if I could contemporize this method in terms of what I call it, I'll call it zonked or winning. Or maybe to use the terms of the text, woe, blessed. I told you this method was nothing new. It had been used all the way back to the early life and times of God's people as they were under the guidance of Moses. If we look to Deuteronomy chapter 11, and I might add here, you do know that Deuteronomy is actually a sermon, the whole book of Deuteronomy. I get people that complain about my sermons going too long, but think about Moses preaching the book of Deuteronomy to people. That was a sermon, right?
In Deuteronomy chapter 11, we hear this all or nothing didactic style of teaching first being proclaimed in Moses' words to the people of Israel that had been given to him first by God. Verses 26 to 28. See, I am setting before you today a blessing and a curse. Now you got to remember that Moses is preaching this sermon while they stand on the precipice of the Jordan River, waiting to cross over after 40 years of wandering into the promised land of Canaan. And Moses says, today I am setting before you a blessing and a curse. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you today, and the curse, if you do not obey the commandments of the Lord your God, but turn aside from the way that I am commanding you today to go after gods that you have not known, that you will soon be exposed to in the land of Canaan. Blessings come for the people that follow God's ways. Curses come for people that reject them and chase after other gods. Did you hear it in there? It's an all or nothing affair. Blessing or curse. Obey the commandments of the Lord your God, be blessed. Disobey the commandments of the Lord your God, zonk. He didn't say that, but it would have been cooler in the book of Deuteronomy had he. And all this in light of the first commandment. The first commandment, you shall have no other gods before me, God said. Before the one true God, Yahweh, you can have no other gods. You will live if you follow him, follow other gods, be cursed, and die. And this either-or way of choosing was a way to teach God's people that they should always look not to be cursed. Who wants that? Who wants to get zonked? Having only two choices before you should make it painfully obvious that you don't want this one, you do want this one. Instead of going the way your heart wants you to go, go the way the Lord your God wants you to go, the way that leads the path of eternal life. Now, I got to admit, this is a pretty simple way of understanding things when you start to evaluate it for what it is. And I'm also going to admit to you that I'm not usually a fan of oversimplifying things. Just ask anybody that's been to one of my Bible studies and how I can carry on and on and on and take things from being black and white and making them the gray matter stuff. We did it today in Bible class. If you've never been, you should come. I know that's not a really rousing advertisement for it, but it is the place where God's people find what God's Word has to teach them and get to work it out in a safe environment, is Bible study, when we study God's Word. But like I said, I don't like to oversimplify things. And if you think about it, I can give you a couple of examples. Let's start with an easy one. Heaven or hell? Well, what are you going to choose if you had your choice? Who's going to choose hell? Nobody. And while it's true there are only two options here, the question behind the statement of heaven or hell becomes a much more difficult one. Because the difficult part of this equation isn't the options themselves, but it's the judgment that has to occur in order to determine which or the other. For instance, if one can only merit heaven on account of their own righteousness, well, then there would be no one in heaven because no one is righteous, not even one, the scriptures teach. But if one can only merit heaven on account of Christ's righteousness, then everyone should be in heaven, and it doesn't matter what the person does or doesn't do. But what we know from the scriptures is it's not that easy either way. What the scriptures reveal to us is that there are indeed people in heaven, but there are also people in hell. And so which is it? It's not one or the other. It's both, and it's somewhere in between. And that's a problem when you oversimplify. And at the first service this morning, this one hadn't even really dawned on me, but I got to thinking about it when I was doing the readings of all things, so I'll share this with you as well. Reading through Luke's gospel today, it struck me that there's another place that we could look to when you go wrong if you just oversimplify. The last several verses of today's gospel lesson, starting at verse 24. Woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation.
Do you realize that in 21st century America, we live better, richer than any people in all history of all time that came before us? We do. As one of my seminary professors used to say, who was a runner, by the way, he said, if you have more than two pairs of shoes in your closet, you got more shoes in your closet than 90% of the people on earth today. We are richer than we have ever been in history. And if you just simply understand that and read this line from Jesus, woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation, that means there will not be a rich person in heaven. It would be easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle. But that's not true. Or read on, woe to you who are full now, for you shall be hungry. I told the people at the first service before I came in today, normally I fix the coffee, bring it with me, but today I chose to have my coffee at home because yesterday morning I made some fresh cinnamon rolls and I had a couple still there. So I had not one, not two, but three with my coffee before coming in today. And I'm full still. Woe to you who are full now, for you shall be hungry. I'm in big trouble. Is it black or white? Woe to you who laugh now. I heard you laughing about how big my belly is. I heard you. Woe to you who laugh now, for you shall mourn and weep. It's not funny that pastor's overweight because he eats too many cinnamon rolls because he's too rich. Woe to you when people speak well of you, for so their fathers did to the false prophets. You see, the problem when you oversimplify things is you lose the meaning that stands behind it. And so I'm not a fan of oversimplification. But then I got to tell you, I'm also not a fan of overcomplicating things. And I know people would argue me on that point, as if they think that I do. If you make it too difficult, too overly complex, people can't decide or discern for or against. And I have a case in point that's here in church today. My oldest son. He's going to kill me for this. But I didn't think about it until I preached this at the first sermon too today. We go through the grocery line when he's a little kid, and you know they've got the candy rack right there, and you can say, pick anything you want right there from the candy rack. But remember, choices have consequences, so he'd stand there like this. For how long? It would never end. He couldn't make up his mind, because if you overcomplicate it, every choice of candy is a good choice of candy. Is it not? So how do you make a decision? There's too many choices to make right here. Sorry, Cole. When there's simply too many choices, it's too difficult. It overcomplicates things. So God, through the church, and in its early teaching styles, even dating back to Moses, like the one that we're observing here in Luke, blessings, curses, blessings, woes, well, our God simplifies it for us here in Luke. And he gives us the KISS method. Keep it simple, stupid. You guys have heard of it? And in spite of its surface level simplicity, this style of teaching can be helpful for us. Because it can serve to guide people in the right way to go. All of this teaching style of blessings and woes or curses can be seen in today's gospel lesson of the Beatitudes. Now, I told you before services, I've always been a fan of the Beatitudes in the Matthean version of it. It begins in Matthew chapter 5. Up to that point in Matthew's gospel, Jesus has done no public proclamation whatsoever. It is the beginning of his ministry on earth to his disciples. And the very first word, check me on this if you like, that he speaks to his disciples is Makarios, blessed. Jesus, God and fleshed, calls his people, his disciples, blessed. And if that's what he calls you, that's what you are. Now you see why I've always gravitated toward Matthew's version of the Beatitudes? Because I love what it means to me. That God reminds me, above all else, the first word out of Jesus' mouth to me, his disciple, is that I am blessed. Well, Luke doesn't quite go that way. Luke uses this didactic teaching method of blessings and woes. While these Beatitudes are parallels to one another, Jesus is framing them with woes in their telling of the story in Luke chapter 6. I'll give you all four of them. The first beatitude speaks of the poor. Verse 20, blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. And then it is framed by verse 24, woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. The second beatitude speaks of the hungry. Verse 21, blessed are you who are hungry now, for you shall be satisfied. And the woe in verse 25 goes with it, woe to you who are full now, for you shall be hungry. The third beatitude speaks of those who are crying or mourning. Blessed are you who weep now, for you shall laugh. And the third woe speaks to those who are laughing, woe to you who laugh now, for you shall mourn and weep. And the fourth beatitude speaks of those who are hated and reviled on account of Jesus' name. Blessed are you when people hate you, when they exclude you and revile you and spurn your name as evil on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for behold, your reward is great in heaven, for so their fathers did to the prophets. And then the fourth woe in verse 26, woe to you when people speak well of you, for so their fathers did to the false prophets. In a clearly perceived pattern of blessings and woes, good and evil, prize and zonk, Jesus teaches his disciples using a method that had long since been employed, dating back to and before Moses, dating back to the garden. Here is a tree, the fruit of which you shall not eat or touch. Eat it and touch it, you shall die. Stay away from it and you shall live. In essence, here in Luke, Jesus teaches that all the things we find to be the highest and most honorable things, the things that we would desire with all of our heart and all of our soul and all of our mind, those things invoke woes from God. And all those things that are the lowest, most despicable things, the things that nobody would really want, the things that are the greatest in the eyes, or excuse me, the things that are the most despicable in the eyes of the world, those are the things that God will bless and bless through. It seems sort of strange, doesn't it? But folks, I would tell you, this is a cause for hope for you and I who are in Christ. Look around you. I think of the fourth beatitude, blessed are you when people hate you, when they exclude you and revile you and spurn your name as evil on account of the Son of Man. I bear the name of Christ. Not only do I bear the name of Christ, but I am a speaker of God's word, a preacher of God's word, a teacher of God's word to God's people. And what I can tell you from being this and doing this in my life is that God's word is not really held in very high esteem nowadays. Speak against matters of sexuality, speak creation versus evolution, speak just about any truth of the scriptures out into the world today, and people will quickly revile it and hold you in low esteem. And that's not just feeling sorry for myself, that's just the truth. I've told people about the job that I do is I'm basically one step away from a false accusation, which is probably true in many cases that I've preached God's word, that people take the wrong way or don't like it because it steps on their sensibilities, from being removed from office or being removed from my vocation. Christianity is reviled, which explains why it is shrinking nowadays, because it's not easy to stay true to God's word in the face of a world that hates God's word. The true word of God, while we who are on the inside know that it has power and speaks truth to a world that rejects it, this truth is indeed rejected, despised, and even persecuted. The meek and the mild and the lowly things of this world, the things that are not, seem to keep on losing, don't they? God says that there is a great reversal coming, however. Jesus, in his word, proclaims woes on the things of this world that are held in high esteem, celebrity, money, power, authority. Jesus says, I have all authority and power in my hands, And what he promises is that there is blessings for those things that are not, for those things that are least in the eyes of the world. And in the midst of the struggle, it's hard to see it sometimes. It's hard to believe it. Don't I know, as a proclaimer of this truth? But don't I also know that about the rest of you, I know how our God works. Our God is always and forever working through great reversals. And all I can say about how God's got in store to work is, whoa, but not W-O-E, W-H-O-A. Whoa, whoa, I am blessed. Even though things don't ever really look that great for me, things are always kind of difficult in the face of the world and its rejection of God's word, I can say, whoa, our God has blessed me tremendously. This is what Jesus is teaching his disciples, and this is what gives me hope. The whole ministry is a ministry of reversal of sorts. Not unlike let's make a deal. People have the opportunity to have all kinds of wonderful prizes as a result of this ministry of God's word. Take up the way of the Lord your God, which is never the easy option. Let's all admit together, what does Jesus say? Take up your cross and follow me. A cross is an instrument of torture and death. Jesus doesn't say, take up your leather couch and your servants who will fan you and keep you cool and feed you grapes, each one by one as you want them, because life is easy cheesy peasy on the highway that I'm paving out for you here. No, Jesus says, take up your cross. Follow me. This way that I have delivered to you is not an easy way. He knows it. Seek my will over the will of this world, and though this world may reject you for it, you will be blessed. Jesus promises so. I believe it because we have the perfect example of it. Jesus himself. Though he had all power and glory and might, the Son of God, born who could command myriads of armies of angels to come down and protect him in times of need, Jesus would forego all of this power and glory. And he would teach each one of us that the Son of Man, though he had all these things, which is unspoken, did not come to be served. He came to serve and give his life as a ransom for many. How did he do it? Jesus looked like he'd been zonked as he carried the instrument of his own torture and death towards a hill called Golgotha. The Son of God, all powerful, all glorious, spit upon, reviled, tortured, and downtrodden, nailed to a tree, hung up, and railed on by one of the criminals hung next to him. It looked as though those who put him there, who had authority, responsibility, power in the eyes of the world, they had all of the adoration of the people, which is why they wanted Jesus out of the way. By their cunning, by their power, by their scheming, it looked as though they had triumphed, with Jesus being eliminated there at the cross, so as to not cause them any cause of concern in the future. And just when they thought they had triumphed and won the big prize of their own self-glorification, God reversed their self-perceived success. Remember, woe to those who speak well of you, or woe to those when the people speak well of you. For Jesus and his followers, about whom Jesus himself said in John 15, if the world hates you, you know that it has hated me before it hated you. And if you were of the world would love you as its own. But because you are not of the world, but because I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Jesus states in no uncertain terms that you will be hated for his name. You will be the lowly. And there, even in the example of Jesus at the cross, we saw it amongst his own disciples, none of whom were there to see it happen. Scattered, denial of Jesus as their leader, running for their very lives. For all these people, beginning with Jesus himself, however, there are blessings. There is life everlasting. Because of the cost of what Jesus paid for there at the cross, he gave his very life so that you would have blessing. He took into himself the woes so that you would receive the blessings that he came to deliver. He was cursed. He died. He was laid behind a door, a stone rolled in front of the tomb. You know what's behind door number one? Let's open it and see. When you roll back the stone, it looks like he had been zonked. It looked like all the believers in Christ had been spoofed and they had nothing because the tomb is empty. There's nothing behind door number one. But folks, while it would appear that we'd been zonked, the prize of greatest worth was behind that door. An empty tomb is the prize of all who would follow this same Jesus and who would go the way that he has called us to go. It's not a zonk because there's nothing there. You realize that this empty tomb is the greatest prize ever because it's empty because Jesus is risen. He's risen indeed. Hallelujah. And for all who believe that he is risen, whoa, W-H-O-A, blessings galore, life eternal, the grave empty. For all who believe in Jesus, will go as he has, Paul writes in Romans 6, and as I paraphrase, baptized into Christ, you've died with him. And if you've died with him in a death like his, you shall certainly, certainly be resurrected like he has been. This is Christian hope. This is reversal. This is blessing, not curse. This is what happens when you go the way that our God has given us to go. And indeed, God has revealed to his faithful, his disciples, that no deal needs to be made, for the deal is done. Jesus has won, and that means so do you. And we all get to go home with the prize. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all human understanding, may it guard your hearts, your minds, and keep you in faith in Christ Jesus and keep you from being zonked for life eternal. Amen. Please stand as we join together and confess our common faith in the triune God using the words of the Apostles' Creed. We confess. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the holy Christian church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We pray, Heavenly Father, your kingdom has been made manifest through the preaching and miracles of Jesus Christ. So gather together your great multitude from every Gentile nation and from Judea's remnant, that many would know the wisdom has come in our flesh. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Grant, O Lord, that your people would always hold fast to the word that has been preached to them and would not believe it in vain. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Preserve family and all godly Christian homes. Give parents diligence and persistence in their duties to teach the faith in both word and example. Keep children in the promise that you made to them in their baptism. Let the patience, kindness, and endurance of Christian love have no end among us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O God, do not let our rewards and blessings consist of the treasures and goods of this world, but instead give to us joy in every sorrow, knowing that if we have you, we lack nothing, and that we will indeed receive an eternal reward in Christ that will never fail. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Bless all those who trust in you, O Lord, and come together as the body of Christ here in this place to receive your word that draws us in. Create and sustain faith through this word and help us to share this faith with the world around us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord, your Son has risen from the dead and has promised that he will only be the first fruits among those who sleep. Preserve us in Christ Jesus with a hope that goes beyond this life. Comfort all those who mourn with the certainty of Christ's resurrection, and let each of us live in confident expectation of the glories that you have in store for us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We entrust these petitions to your great care, loving Father, confident in your mercy for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who is worshipped together with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated as we now sing hymn number 537, Beautiful Savior. Congregation, to please rise as we join together singing the offertory.
What shall I render to the Lord for all his benefits to me? I will offer the sacrifice of thanksgiving and will call on the name of the Lord. I will take the cup of salvation and will call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord now in the presence of all his people in the courts of the Lord's house. In the midst of you, O Jerusalem.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen.
Please be seated as we sing our closing hymn, Blessed Are They.
Well, good morning, or I guess it's probably good afternoon. Yep, it's good afternoon time.
Welcome once again. It's my pleasure to be able to share with you the Word of God, the blessings and not the curses. The curses have been received by Christ, and now all that's left is the blessings for each and every one of us. So it makes my job, even though it can sometimes feel like you're facing the big enemy that is always winning, the truth of the matter is that we've already won. And even though it doesn't look like it and the victory doesn't look like it's anything special in the eyes of the world, we have the real knowledge of the victory in Christ. And so it's a pleasure to be always able to preach and proclaim that. A couple of two or three quick announcements, then I'll turn you loose. I know you can read, and I know this is in the bulletin, but we've had an ad kind of running in the bulletin for a little while. And some backstory. This is on the foot care ministry, which we're looking to get up and running again starting in March. I know Linda, she didn't ask me to make this announcement, I'm just making it, because I know she has been advertising for some helpers to come in and help get that up and running again. It takes a lot of hands to get the foot care ministry running again, and we are a body of Christ, and some of us can be hands in it while some of us are the mouthpiece, and doesn't mean that I don't have to be the hands too, but I just wanted to put a plug out there for you guys that before I ever, I can't say I'm new anymore. I've been here for a year and a half or more, so that doesn't actually fly for me to throw that out there. But before I ever came here and I was sort of evaluating where I was at versus coming here and do I make that switch to come here, one of the things that attracted me to this congregation as I looked at the things that you did was your willingness to serve your community, not unlike what I said in the pulpit just a little bit ago that Jesus himself said that he came to do. The Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and give his life as a ransom for many. And I was sufficiently impressed with this church. You know, you've got the food bank, and you've got the Ozark Center of Hope that you support, and you have the foot care ministry, which there's nothing like it in all of Synod. You're the only one that does that. And it appeared to me, on the outside looking in, that you cared deeply for your community. And I do still believe that. And I think this is an opportunity for us as we bring it back up online for people to serve in it and to serve others in a way that is unusual and yet has been requested and is needed amongst us. So that's sort of my plug and encouragement to you that that we could certainly use your help if you'd be willing to do so. The other one is also in the bulletin. It ran a couple weeks back, but those of you that remember or know Pastor Taglauer and his wife Helene, who generally will come and join us for this service if he's not engaged, maybe helping fill a pulpit somewhere else. A couple of weeks back, he said that his wife, Helene, will on occasion take her rings off, her wedding band off, and put it in a little velvet bag. And they think they may have left it here at church. They oftentimes will sit like in this row. I'm not sure exactly where, but if you guys would, we've looked through the pews, but maybe other eyes could see it. Take a look around church. If you see a little velvet bag like that, they're still looking for it. He said to take it out of the announcements a couple weeks back, and then Thursday morning at men's Bible study, he said, would you be so kind as to include that, because we still have yet to find her wedding band. And I know that has caused them some consternation, so they would appreciate it if they could find it and if you could help if you see it. May not be here, but we'll look anyway. And then the last thing that I wanted to talk about for just a quick second is a quick plug for our Lenten services. So Lent is a 40-day period of preparation for the coming of Christ in the week that we refer to as the Passion Week. Started in the 4th century by Pope Leo the Great. It was set aside as a time of thinking through and reflecting on who we are for that 40-day period. And 40 days always has some significance to Christians. 40 years of wandering, Jesus' 40 days of temptation. But it's a time that begins with Ash Wednesday, which is about 2.5 weeks from now, where we will mark ourselves with ashes and signifying, you know, that we understand that we are, well, I always say, you are but dust. And then at one point a couple years back, I think it was the kids that pointed out to me, you're but dust? That's even lower than dust. Which it's true. So you're but dust. And you're as good as dead because of your sins. And we mark ourselves with that on Ash Wednesday. You know, Fat Tuesday comes before, and you hear all the stuff about the New Orleans stuff, and that's sort of a build-up to it, and it's a tradition that's gone, I think, too far. But it's good to remember that 40-day period that's marked at the beginning of Ash Wednesday that culminates with Easter Sunday, to remember who we are. And that season of preparation we make some room for extra services in that, and so we'll have Wednesday midweek services. We'll be doing those at 10 in the morning and 6 p.m. in the evening, and that's sort of meant to satisfy kind of all different types of comers, people that don't want to be out after dark in the evening, although by 6 we should still be light after that, for the working people that work and can't get here before 6. So we'll try and cover it from either side. It's the same service morning and evening, all with the exception of Maundy Thursday, which I'll explain that later. But I'm excited to bring to you a series that we're doing from the Gospel of Luke, which is specifically just on the Passion that we'll be examining throughout that 40 days. And I can tell you, as one who has experience preaching and studying texts and preparing them to be able to deliver to you, a couple of weeks ago I went to St. Louis for a preparatory thing on this series that I'll be doing with the guy that wrote it, the guy that preached at my installation here, Jeff Gibbs, Dr. Jeff Gibbs. The exercise that we did for the first 3 hours of the class that I took that day was just to reread Luke chapters 22 and 23, the Passion narrative of Jesus, the arrest and the crucifixion and the resurrection account, which we're going to break up into the different parts that we'll preach at that midweek series. And I have to confess that I was stunned with how many details, even though I study this regularly and preach it, how many details in that account I missed or was unaware of or had forgotten. And so it just reminded me what a great time it is that we actually set aside some time to come and do that. So this is sort of my shameless plug to come and be a part of that. Prepare yourselves. Prepare your hearts and minds. If indeed the world is warring against the church, and the church seems to be shrinking in the face of that, that is a sign of the end times. And I'm not, you know, fear-mongering with you by any means. What I'm telling you is that the Lord has called upon his people to stay faithful even unto death. And I will give you the crown of life. And I picked on my son once already today for not being able to pick out candy from the candy rack, but I'm going to uplift him because that's his confirmation verse, is Revelation 2:10. Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. And there in that verse, you have sort of this dichotomy painted. Stay faithful. Death may come, difficulty may come, but if you stay faithful in the face of it, if you follow the way of the Lord, it's the same thing that Jesus is saying. There isn't woes and death and curses awaiting you. There's life and blessings forevermore. And so the church has been called upon to stay faithful in times like this. And so one of the ways we do it is we practice our faith maybe even more vehemently in a time and in a season when it's required of us. So there you have it. Now I've kept you too long. Have a blessed day and week in the name of the Lord.